My special guest today is a comical Liverpool actor who has appeared in film, TV and theatre. It's my pleasure to welcome to the show Mr. Warren Donnelly. How are you doing, sir?
I'm very well, thank you. Thank you for having me on.
It's great having you on. It's been a while. Been a long time. How's life in Cannon Street at the moment back there?
Well, life in Canning Street is all right. It's a strange old time, no two ways about it, with the whole lockdown and pandemic. But, you know, I think we're all just getting on with it. And hopefully there'll be some kind of light at the end of the tunnel, I hope.
I think they will. I think it's been too long now, you know. Warren, which part of our fine city were you born?
Originally, Old Swan, I'm from. Yeah, Old Swan, Green Lane, Old Swan. We lived in a crumbling terrace house that faced the bus depot. So that's, and I've still got a lot of family around that area. Right. So, yeah, originally Old Swan.
I used to sing in the pub up there called, well, a few up there actually. I used to do Mad Mondays at the Garfield.
Yeah, the Garfield's still going, I think. For what, still going? The Garfield's still going strong.
I'm trying to think of the other things around there I used to play. Things, venues, the Highfield Tenants.
Yeah, there's like a good little pub crawl around there, or there always was. There's always lots of pubs. So, yeah, there's the Highfield Tenants, the Glass House, the Red House, you know, the White House.
Let's get into your acting here. Did you start acting from an early age?
Yeah, I used to go to the Everyman New Theatre when I was about 9, 10, that sort of age. And then a little bit in senior school, we did some acting, and then there was lots of things like woodwork and metalwork that I was no good at. So I used to go to, yeah, like youth theatres and stuff. So, yeah, from a kid. And as a kid, I did a little bit of telly work. So, yeah, bits and bobs, but from an early age, yeah.
Well, I first met you at the legendary Jarvis Training and Management in Liverpool. Which was a music and drama course back in the early 90s. Let's talk a little bit about Jarvis and its merry characters.
Well, Jarvis, I mean, it was set up, I think it was the days of John Major's government or maybe Margaret Thatcher's, I can't remember, but they said to companies, you set up a training centre and we'll give you money. So Jarvis, which specialised in building and things like that, they set up this place for people. If you've been out of work, you could go and study music, you could do your drama, your poetry, your acting, whatever it was creative. And I worked there for about 3 and a bit years.
Yeah.
And it was like nowhere I've ever worked before or since. It was its own little world. All human life went through the doors there. I mean, I've said this to people before. There was the outside world, and then there was the world of Jarvis. And then you walked through those double doors. Because it was an old school building, wasn't it?
It was, yeah. I think it was the old Francis Xavier's, was it? School,
something like that.
I think.
And it wasn't particularly big, but it seemed big because it was so crammed full of people. Yeah. I mean, I walked past there recently, a few times actually, from out about walking, and it's been demolished. But you stand outside, where it was, all the memories come flooding back. You know what
There's
I mean?
A lot of memories there, isn't it? Because I first went there when it was Seconds Out Theatre, before I went to Jarvis, with Anne Hollingshead and her daughter, Nikki, as I recall.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
But a lot of characters there, Warren, wasn't he? Let's talk a little bit about the characters in Jarvis. Michael Tate,
merciless mimic he was known as, wasn't he? No, Michael Tate, he's somebody I've now known for what seems like forever. And I suspect he'll outlive me. I mean, I think he should have made... He's indestructible, Michael Tate. He's, if you're in Liverpool, chances are you'll have walked past Michael Tate at some point in the street, or you will have met him. Everybody seems to know him. And he's a complete and utter one-off.
He is, isn't he? Yeah, but Elvis act...
Well, yeah,
in the middle of this.
He's on the short side, isn't he, Michael? You have to say, he's a small guy. And he had an act for a while called Elvis. So he had like a little sort of Elvis jumpsuit made with all the rhinestones. And he'd go out as Elvis. And, you know, I don't know if people liked his act or not. It didn't matter. Michael liked doing it. So he was on stage and he'd be giving it loads. And he was very much the kind of person you got Jarvis, you know.
And no fear. Absolutely no fear.
He'd do a gig anywhere. I mean, if he'd get a gig on the Titanic, I would be the last person off the ship as the water was rising, you know. So, I mean, Jarvis, it was full of a lot of people like that because I think there's a lot of people who want to act and you want to perform and you want to sing, but they don't always find a way of doing it.
Yeah.
Whereas you could go to Jarvis and you're allowed to get up there and strut your stuff, sing your songs, do your acting, write your own plays. And I think an awful lot of people really got a lot out of it, you know. Because it was its own little magical world, wasn't it? You know?
Well, it was good because a lot of like companies come in and films and stuff, and they give a lot of extra work as well to the people in there, wouldn't they? And they'd be in
films
and stuff as well as and the actors, like the good actors at Jarvis, they'd actually get parts, like yourself, you know, they'd get parts. But it was something at the time I always wanted to have a go at, a bit of acting, because I'd done music forever, still doing music. But I was okay, I got through a couple of things, but. I wasn't, you know, I wasn't of any calibre of yourself or anybody else in there. Some great, I mean, you got Al Cozzi, was one of our tutors, wasn't he? Legendary
Al Cozzi, yeah. He's another one, another person, Al. He's like a Liverpool Lawrence himself, old Cozzi. And I mean, I worked with him for those 3 years, and every day he had me crying with laughter. I don't think I've ever laughed so much in all my life than I worked with Al. And, you know, the great thing about people like Al and Tatey and all those people, and everybody who was there, you know, it's, I think if you want to perform, then it's inside you, and it's not going to go away. So you need to scratch that itch. Mm. And places like Jarvis, it gave people opportunities, I'd say, to perform and do the stuff. And I think, you know, most people in the world don't want to stand on stage. Most people in the world don't want to stand up on the bus, particularly, and draw attention to themselves. So if you do want to stand on stage, and you do want to sing, and you do want to perform and prance around in front of a camera, you know, you've got to do it. And the great thing with Jarvis and Cozzy and the people who worked there, you know, there was a forum for people to get up and do stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I thought the tutors were great. You know, you had Bernie Merrick, our friend Bernie Merrick, and Yvonne Barber.
Yeah.
You know, they put a lot of stuff together, didn't they? A lot of productions together. And
Well, there was productions. There was like a music studio there, if you remember.
Yeah, I got some records out. It was great for me because, as you remember, it was like, it was your dole and an extra tenner a week. You didn't have to sign on, and you went to the world of Jarvis.
A week, and you got your expenses on top. So depending where you lived, you were doing all right, you know.
Yeah, I mean, expenses day on a Thursday, we all get partly down to penny farthing in town.
Well, expenses day, there'd be all sorts of people you never saw during the rest of the week. But and there'd be a queue right round the block. And there'd be like bags of 20 pence pieces everywhere and 50 pence pieces that weighed sort. And people would come in and get their few quid, you know. And I don't regret working there at all. I mean, I had three very, sometimes bizarre, but very funny times at that place.
Me too. And I've got an NVQ out of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, I still meet people to this day who go, hey, Jarvis, because it seemed like everybody in the world went through the place at one point. But it's a good way of saying to people, look, you know, if nothing's going on and you're out of work and, you know, it's doing your head in, come in here for a bit, for 6 months or whatever it was, and get away from that. You know, and I think people made friendships there. I think a few marriages were forged in that place, a few relationships, and maybe in a few divorces, I don't know. But I think, you know, and you know, there were good nights out, weren't there?
There were great nights out. Yeah,
Chazzy gigs. I mean, it was sort of it was a good old time, I think.
There's some good bands as well. I mean, I remember Paul Acho's band, Latex Love Child.
Yeah.
Great band. Ian Streets on drums, great drummer Streets. Yeah, I remember all these people.
That's right, yeah. And one of the other bands did a gig in London on the marquee, if I remember correctly. And we all got a coach, can't remember which one, and went down to London for the day.
Well, do you know what? I tell you, a guitar player you might remember, Joe Peden.
Yes, yeah.
Joe was at Jarvis. Years and years and years after Jarvis, I met my wife in the Grapes pub in Matthew Street. And we'd been going out for a few months. And it turns out that was a cousin. And we went to his mum's one day, and there he was.
Well, that's Jarvis for you, isn't it?
That's Jarvis for you, yeah. Do you still keep in touch with any of the guys from there?
Joe Peden I haven't seen in years, but I did see a lot of him for quite a while. But people like Bernie Merrick, I'm still in touch with. Yvonne, I'm still in touch with. Paul Acho, I'm still in touch with.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, especially in this day and age of, like, Facebook, I mean, you're in touch with all sorts of people, and people crop up who you haven't thought about in years, you know.
That's right. And there's a lot of Facebook groups now as well. I know there's an actual Jarvis group, which I did join recently. I looked at some of the old pictures there. There's some great photos, you know. And anyway, that's our memories of Jarvis. I had to put that in today because...
It was a great place.
Warren, you've appeared in panto for many years as well as film and TV. You're probably best known for your part as Stan the policeman in Shameless, the British version of Shameless, because the US listeners here, there is an actual American version over here now. William H. Macy plays Frank Gallagher, but in the original, you played Stan, the harassed policeman. Did you find you get recognise more from playing this character from all the other stuff you've done?
Yeah, well, it's strange because, I mean, I've done a lot of stuff before Shameless and I've done a lot of stuff after Shameless, but Shameless was like the big... It was one of those programmes that became a hit overnight, immediately. And naively, I never thought I'd get recognised particularly from it because I was just part of the cast. I was one person in the show. But suddenly it became a hit straight away and then people start going, oh, it's you, isn't it? And that was a bit strange at first. I mean, most of the feedback is nice, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And, I remember doing the audition, getting the job, doing the first bit of filming that I did. in the summer, and it wasn't until the following year, the January, February. So I'd sort of forgotten about it because I was off doing other things. And then they started broadcasting it, and it was just one of those television programs that it seemed to strike a chord at that time. And I don't know why things are successful and things aren't successful, but Shameless immediately was. And I was sort of in this show that everybody seemed to be talking about and loved and had an opinion about.
Yeah.
And you think, oh, right, well, I didn't see that coming. So, yeah, I still to this day get recognised from it, quite often by people who have been too young to watch it the first time around. So, like, you know, people who watched it with the mum and the dad, or whose mum and dad watched it, I should say, originally, which makes me feel very old because they're all like 19, 20, you know. I feel like an old codger. And, yeah, I mean, still.
Well, that's it. In the days of Prime now, Amazon Prime and Netflix, there's a lot of stuff coming back. A lot of this generation are watching stuff from back then. As you say, it's coming back again. It's all getting repeated. But you've been in so many other roles as well. You know, you've done Coronation Street, you've done Cold Feet, Holby City, Life on Mars.
Life on Mars regularly gets shown on British cable TV as well as Netflix. That's another one that I get recognised for. Yeah. It's mad, you know.
Well, during the lockdown here, me and the missus began watching a series on BritBox. We got a thing called BritBox out here. And a show called Moving On. It was a series called Moving On, created by Jimmy McGovern. And we're watching it one night, and there you were.
Yeah. Well, that, when I did that job, I signed to do the job, did the audition, got the job, signed the contract. Then had an accident and broke my leg really badly. So when I did that show, they had to prop me up because I'm crutches. So any shots that I'm in, they've got me propped up to stop me from falling over. But that was a really good job, a really good script, a really good director and crew, and the lead guy in it, really good actor and a good atmosphere. You know, I mean, most of the acting jobs I've done, there's been a good atmosphere because, you know, but occasionally you do the odd job where you think, oh, this isn't much fun, or there's a bit of tension on the set. And I don't like all that, you know. I'd rather sort of have a nice working environment like everybody. Mm. And that was an example of a really good hard work and getting the work done, getting it all out the way, you know, and getting the scenes filmed, but in a very positive way. So very happy memories of that job. Not the happy memories of the broken leg. That wasn't as fun. And it was very nice not to recast me. Because the minute I broke my leg, I thought, well, that's that job gone, you know. I'm like, no, don't worry. We can film around you. And I went, phew.
Where is that filmed? I know it's definitely around Liverpool. I see different parts of the city. Do they have a base?
Yeah, the base of it is by Kirkdale train station. So off County Road, Kirkdale, like.
Okay.
And they tend to film in and around that area because that area, I mean, it's like a lot of Liverpool. It looks good on camera. You know, it's got like a sort of like a, how would you describe it? It's got a realness to it, you know, and they can film on their own doorstep. I mean, that's why there's an awful lot of filming in Liverpool, because Liverpool looks like lots of different places. And for a relatively small city, there's a lot of very different locations. So they seem to film that in and around that sort of Kirkdale, Anfield, Walton sort of area.
The latest one's just come on over here, and I've seen one a few nights ago. Mickey Stark, Les Dennis, Ted Robbins, and Jake Abrahams, they were all in it.
That's right, yeah.
About Les Dennis meeting, they're out on the lash every night. They're eating bad, and he goes to a personal trainer, and the others are wondering where he's gone. I don't really even see in the episode, but because people don't realise, you know, despite everything going on, people are still out there. You know, you still see these actors are still, like yourself, out there doing it, you know.
Well, that's the weird thing. I think people think either you've given up if you don't see it on telly every week, or you think you've made £1 million and you've retired, and you go, no. I mean, you know, I think what happens is if you do a lot of telly, then you're very visible. But you're also visible because you're doing theatre and doing other things as well.
Yeah.
It's just that people spot you immediately. And people like, you know, Mickey Stark, Les Dennis, Ted, Jake, all very good actors, all very accomplished actors. I mean, I've worked with them, and they're all very, very good. So you give them a good script like Moving On, which I think is one of the better things that's been made on television in Britain over the past 10 odd years. And you give them a good script like that, and they're very good in it. No two ways about it. It's good quality actors and good quality.
Yeah, the 12 seasons now. The one I've just started with is 12 seasons. Also, there was a thing called The Street I watched too, which was Jim Broadbent was in that.
Oh, brilliant. I mean, absolutely brilliant. You know, really good.
Any favourite roles for you personally?
The best part I've ever had in my life is a theatre piece called God's Official, which was a comedy about two mates who are mad football fans. And that's the best part I've ever had because it used to make me laugh performing it.
Right.
Obviously, I really enjoyed doing Shameless because it gave me a chance to learn a lot as well about working in front of a camera and the television industry. And I got some lovely stuff doing that. But I'm, you know, I've got to be honest with you, I'm always happy to be working. I'm not a snob about the work I do as much stuff as I possibly can. And I'm always very happy and very grateful to be getting any jobs because, as everybody knows, you know, the performing arts can be tough and all the rest of it. So if people want to employ me, I'm happy. And I've done a mixture of, I've done telly, bit of film, lots of theatre, panto, adverts, theatre for kids and educational stuff. And you know what? It's all good. It's all work. That's the way I look at it.
That's good. That's and a good attitude, yeah. Who are your favourite actors?
Favourite actors? I mean, there's loads. I mean, one of the nice things about working on Shameless is that we had some very good people come into it. And sometimes when I worked with a fantastic actress, Anne Reed, I was a bit starstruck meeting her. So there's loads. I mean, there's a whole wide variety of actors because, you know, you're not always stars. I quite like actors who turn up in things and they're just very, very good, you know. And of course, I do love all the Hollywood ones. I mean, you know, your De Niro's and your Pacino's and Jack Nicholson, because you could not, how could you not like them? You know what I mean? Yeah. Real stars, you see stuff like that, and you go, they've got such a thing about them.
Well, I don't know if you've seen Stephen Graham's done so well. I don't know if you've seen him in The Irishman with De Niro.
Yeah.
He plays a New Jersey gangster. Excellent.
Well, he's such a real good actor. Don't you? Once again, you know, really, really good.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's a thing he did recently for Jimmy McGovern that has just been shown over here called Time with Sean Bean. And it was gripping, three-part series set in the prison and edge of the seat. And the two of them, Sean Bean and him, so good. I mean, when that comes on BritBox, which it will do, you've got to watch that. And that was filmed in Liverpool, once again, in and around Kirkdale way, I think.
Yeah.
But really, really, you know, you're as good as anything I've seen from anywhere else. Really good, you know.
Yeah. What's your opinion on, I mean, this has annoyed me for years. There's so many, and being from Liverpool, so proud of Liverpool, some great actors in Liverpool like yourself, there's a lot of Liverpool actors. When you see something and someone's playing a Scouser and it's nothing like us at all, it's just, what's your views on that?
Well, do you know, I think, first of all, if you're going to play the part of somebody from Liverpool, the accent's tricky. It's a very unusual accent, right? Yeah. So that's the first thing. I mean, Liverpool is a city full of very creative people, this city. And so that's the first thing to say. There's an awful lot of musos, actors, creative, interesting people. It's a port, so it's going to be an interesting city anyway, you know, just by the virtue of that. And yes, sometimes you see, I mean, there was this thing that was on not so long ago, and they had a woman doing a Scouse accent, and it was awful. And I'm sure she's a lovely person and a very good actress.
Yeah.
But you go, there's an awful lot of very good actresses in Liverpool have worked with a chunk of them who don't get seen because, and I don't understand why, actually. You know, you think, well, hang on a minute. If you want to employ somebody who can do a proper Scouse accent, get somebody from Liverpool.
That's what I mean, yeah. I mean, sometimes I think, did he do it because, did he put an absolute megastar in? There was one thing one time, I forget the title of it, David Jason was a docker.
Yeah.
And as great as David Jason is, Only Fools and everything else he's done, you know, Touch of Frost and Open All Hours and all that, he wasn't a Scouser, was he?
No, that's the thing. I think, you know, I think sometimes it's because he cast a name, a star. And I think sometimes they just get it wrong and don't think. I mean, you know, it is slightly frustrating because, there are an awful lot of very, very talented actors and actresses in this city who don't really get a look in.
Yeah.
Some of whom, it's partly because they don't push themselves, but they should be getting seen. I mean, you know, it's like auditions are nothing to be frightened of. Casting sessions are nothing to be frightened of. And if you come into a city to make a film, see the local people, I think. Mm. I mean, where I live, I'm right in the middle of town, and there's always a lot of filming by me.
Well, Peaky Blinders was filmed around that way, I think.
Yeah, it's filmed towards Park Road, you know, the big reservoir by that way. So there's always a lot of filming going on. And, you know, you go, well, I think it comes down to the casting directors. You go, you've got this great big resource of people in the city. Mm. So see them. And it does occasionally drive me mad, but it just seems to be the way it is, you know.
Yeah, I was just curious on your opinion on that.
Well, the way it's always worked for me is I very rarely work in Liverpool. It always seems I work away from Liverpool and then come home, which is fine. I mean, go wherever the work is.
Yeah.
But quite often when I'm going to the supermarkets, I do walk past a film set or a TV set, and I think, well, I'm off to the supermarkets here, and that's being filmed around the corner from my house. But that's just the way it is. I mean, I have done some stuff in Liverpool. I did the thing not so long ago, and that's great. You know, I don't mind. As I say, I'll go wherever the work is, but occasionally it does slightly make you think. You know what I mean?
Let's mention your dad. One of Liverpool's treasures, legendary saxophone player Albie Donnelly from the fantastic band Supercharge. And he's still performing, your dad, right?
Still going strong. I mean, obviously, during this period, it's been a bit weird, but he's still gigging. And he's actually got some gigs coming up. And I think one of the lucky things in my life, because my dad's a musician, my brother's a musician, and I've known lots of musicians, I think I treat the acting jobs more like a musician would. I see them as gigs. You know what I mean? So I'm not precious about it. So, yes, there's always been a lot of music. And my dad's been a working professional musician for well over 50 years. More years than he cared to admit. But that's what he's always done. Through thick and thin, he's been a muso. It's his life's sort of work, you know.
Well, I recently read Spencer Lee's book, The Story of the Cavern Club. Your dad was mentioned so many times in that book. Fantastic book of the whole history of the Cavern, how it started, the owners, changing owners. And he played at the last Cavern gig, your dad, before they closed down the original, right?
Yeah, 1973. I think somebody somewhere has got a tape of the show. Yeah. So somebody taped it. And yeah, I mean, he played there. But, you know, once again, the Liverpool music scene, it's so varied. I mean, it's not just Merseybeat. There was jazz groups made up of like mixed races, you know, soul music. I mean, you think about it, Liverpool, the port, the first people to get a lot of those records would be Scousers because people would bring them back from America, you know. So it's a city, Liverpool, soaked in music, you know what I mean? And sports and comedy and everything else.
Yeah.
But music is such a part of the lifeblood of this city.
Yeah, I mean, as you say, my dad told me that, you know, back when he was a kid, his dad was a seafarer. He'd bring back records from the States. Lionels. McCartney's so influenced by Little Richard from an early age. Buddy Holly.
Well, absolutely. Well, Liverpool, I mean, it'd have been like a mixture of like all the American music, folk music, Irish music, country and western.
Yeah.
It's a real melting pot. I mean, my dad played in bands of all sorts as a young guy, you know, like sort of soul stuff, gigged all the time.
Yeah.
Then eventually sort of gigged all around England, all around Europe. And you go, yeah, you know, it's sort of, as it's been his entire life. And I think, to be honest with you, he'll be doing it until the day he drops dead. I don't see him ever retiring. In the same way that I can't ever imagine not wanting to sort of perform an act.
Well, it's what we do, isn't it?
It's the same kind of thing, I think.
Yeah, it's what we do. Yeah, your dad does music, I do music, done it from an early age. You do your acting. It's actually what we do, you know. And it frustrates me sometimes when, you know, people don't see it as a real job. People outside of it, they just don't get it.
Yeah.
I had John Martin on the show, you know, Liverpool comedian John Martin. We were discussing about, he was the first entertainer, comedian, first person in the entertainment industry who got the £40 a week enterprise allowance scheme. I ended up getting it myself.
But, that's right, yeah.
But John was the first, and it was unheard of. And, you know, he went to the job centre in Bootle and he was telling me the story because we were discussing about they don't see it as a real job. And John said, like, it could be like a guy setting up a window cleaning business or a car valeting business. John goes there. As a comedian, he said, I had a plan on it. Yeah, I want to be a comedian. He said, and the girl in the job centre said, are you trying to be funny? He said, well, I am actually.
That's it. I mean, I think people, like with me, I'm my own business. So I do my own tax return. I run my life as my own business in terms of what I do.
Yeah.
And, you know, when people go, oh, acting is just poncing around. Well, yeah, there's an element of poncing around. But I tell you what, you know, some of the hardest work I've ever done as a performer in my life is panto. You do a panto at Christmas. Everybody else puts on a few pounds over Christmas with all that nice food. You lose weight. It's like doing aerobics. And the panto schedule, you're doing two shows a day, sometimes three shows a day. If you're very lucky, you're just doing a one-show day. But you're sort of running around, you're sweating buckets, you're singing, dancing, throwing yourself about, and you go, this is like hard work.
It's high energy, isn't it? It's full of energy.
Well, I always say to any actor who goes, panto, oh, I wouldn't be seen dead. You go, you want to try doing one? If you think it's easy, do one for 6 weeks, every single day for those 6 weeks with the odd day off. And you'll see a very different side to it. And, you know, working as an entertainer, it's graft. Because you've got to turn up. You can't turn up and do things half-baked or half. You can't be bothered. Whether it's a music thing, a comedy, acting thing, you've got an audience. So you have to go on and do it properly. Otherwise, A, you're cheating them. And B, you're cheating yourself or whoever's paying you. So you've got to do it for real, you know. And when people go, it's not a proper job, you go, well, I know a lot of people with proper jobs who get nothing out of those proper jobs and they hate them. And you go, by the way, it is a proper job. I enjoy doing it. So, yeah, I'm right there with anybody, who's gone through that one, because I've heard that over the years.
And so many stories as well. You know, you've got so many stories, so many memories. I mean, the Panto thing doesn't happen over here. I think it's a British thing, really. But I've taken my little girl, she's 10 now, to many musicals here.
Yeah.
I've been so lucky because the place I work on the Riverwalk, Waxy O'Connor's my gig, you go a block away and it's the Majestic Theatre, a very authentic old theatre here. So all the stagehands have drank in our place for years. I've got to know them over the years. They're all close friends now. You know, they actually tell, if a Broadway production comes in or something, they'll tell the cast who are here for the week, that's the place you go. And they come in after, yes, they come in after work. After each night of the show, they come in our place. I've had musicians coming in. Can I jam with you? Hamilton was one guy who got to know David Matos from New York. He said, hey, but I'm doing this show all over the place. I just want something new. Just want to plug my guitar and have a jam with you and a drink after the show.
Yeah, unwind, I suppose.
Yeah. You know, but we've seen so many musicals here, but I get what you're saying about the Panto things, like the musicals here and the running all over the stage, the prop changing and everything.
Yeah.
So much goes into that stuff, the theatre.
It's like being an exercise class. I mean, you burn calories, you sweat cobs, you lose weight. And also, you know, the thing is with Panto, I mean, when I first did my Panto, the first Panto I ever did, I should say, I was 40, 41, something like that. Yeah. And I thought Panto had been and gone, because obviously, as a little boy, I went to it. And I was amazed it's for the kids and for the little kids who are your daughter's age or younger. Or they do. It's magical. They love it. They believe it. It's like the best thing ever because they're in this theatre. There's special effects. There's goodies and baddies. There's booing. There's songs. There's a handsome hero, a beautiful princess. And the kids absolutely love it. And they get everything out of it. So you go, so you can't knock it. You can't look down your nose at it. You go, no, you've got the best job in the world. You're entertaining whole families and children for like 2 hours. That's the best thing they've ever seen in their life until they go and see the next show. And that's the way it should be when you're a kid.
I've all seen Panto as a kid. I remember seeing Ken Dodd at the Empire when I was about 7 or 8. And the Diddy Man. That was fantastic. But I'll tell you the quick story here, talking about the kids. I had my little girl at a Peter Pan show here.
Oh, yeah.
A lady called Kathy Rigby. We get to the show. My little girl's only about 3. So she's dressed as Tinkerbell for the Peter Pan thing. We're sitting down. So my buddy comes over from the mixing desk. He said, I've got a present here for your little girl. And it's a crocodile, so she's holding it. So we're watching the show. Anyway, there's an interval. And I goes over to chat to Justin at the mixing board. So I've got up my little girl. I'm holding her. She just fell asleep on my shoulder. I just happened to turn around, and there's this little kid holding the crocodile. I said, oh, excuse me. I said, that's my little girl. Can we have that back? I'm trying to get off this little kid, and there's this tug of war. And I'm like, yeah, no, it's hers. The grandmother goes, that's hers, right? My wife looks at me, walks away, and it just turns out, I didn't realise it was the actual merchandise from the show, the crocodile in Peter Pan. So they all had them, and I looked up, my little girl had dropped hers.
Well, they've all got like the swizzle sticks and the little sort of magic wands, and the little kids come dressed as the characters.
Yeah.
If you're doing Cinderella, all the little girls have got Cinderella dresses on.
Yeah.
I mean, if I do Panto, I'm either the Daft King, who's like a comic part, or I'm the baddie. Okay. Right, yeah. And I'm quite a good as a baddie because I'm sinister enough, and it's the only job you ever want to be booed. If you're not getting booed off the stage as the baddie, you're not doing your job. And there's nothing better than when you're the baddie and the kids think you're going to win the day, and they can't stand you. And then of course you lose, and they all cheer because you've been defeated. And if you're the Daft King, you get them all laughing anyway because you're daft. And yeah, it's all the merchandise. It's hard work, but it's very rewarding. It's your job. You're there to pull your tripes out and sweat buckets and give it loads because that's what you're there to do, you know. And you know, I love it. I say I really enjoy it, and hopefully I'll be doing it this Christmas as well. Fingers crossed.
But speaking of your family, we were talking about your dad before. I follow your Facebook posts. Your nephew's got to be the cutest kid.
He's a menace as well.
Does he go to the Panto? Does he go and see you when you're in Panto?
Well, he hasn't yet, but I think he's getting to be at the right age because he's only coming up to 4. I said to my sister, I said he's either going to end up on stage or in prison. So he's one or the other. I'll either be going to see him on stage or I'll be going to visit him once a month in some sort of Boston thing. But no, he's a little live wire, so yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if he ends up there. But my other nephew, who's, how old is he now? 20? 19? Yeah, 19. He's actually doing more and more acting work. Done a few short films, and is very good, I have to say. This is not just a proud uncle saying this. He's very good, and he's sort of at college studying it, and he's given it loads. And he's young, slim, and a lot better looking than me, so it's not that I'm jealous or anything. But he's, so he's sort of thrown himself into this whole acting world. And And I say he's a natural, you know, and maybe it'll be the same for my little nephew.
Moving on to lockdown. It's been a rough time for the arts. Theatres are still suffering back home. They're gradually opening here in a couple of months' time. I've seen some adverts for August and September on the theatre I was telling you about earlier. There's some stuff coming on there, but how is it back there right now? Because it's much tighter back home than where I am at the moment. I follow it all the time.
Well, it seems to be. I mean, we're in the situation where, as of July the 19th, we might get some kind of clarity from the government. Can they reopen? I mean, the problem has been that they've left theatres open, but with a limited capacity. So if you've got a limited capacity, you're not going to make any money, which means you can't employ the same amount of actors, you can't employ the same amount of crew, front of house staff. So theatres are booking things ahead, but it's still all a bit tentative. I mean, there's a theatre I'm supposed to be working in this Christmas, and the show's advertised, but nothing's been signed yet because, well, nobody knows, you know. So it's a strange situation. I mean, with the European football, they've had crowds.
I was just going to say, the sporting events, they're bringing it back to the sporting events, and the people in the arts are suffering.
Yeah, sports, there's been sort of like marches. And I think, to be honest with you, at some point, the world and the UK and all the rest of it have got to move forward with this. They've got to find some way of going, look, how can we get back to some kind of normality? Not being daft, maybe being sort of using common sense, but you've got to reopen things like theatres and bars and stuff, because people really start to miss it. And if you keep going into these lockdowns, it will have a negative effect on people's lives in all sorts of ways, not just like work ways and financially, but mentally, emotionally. So hopefully, as of like July 19th, a couple of weeks' time, we might know a bit further. I personally want the theatres back open. I want to get back gigging again. I mean, I've done some acting work during the lockdown, but nowhere near as much as I'd like to have done.
That's what I was going to ask you. Because of the lockdown, what about TV work, adverts, etc.? You're still doing stuff with the current situation, and is the online auditions going on?
Yeah, well, I mean, I did a nice telly job last year, but it was very odd because they had to follow all these different protocols. So you had to test your temperature every time you walked onto the set. You had to stand so far away from other people, so they had to cheat all the shots. You did your own makeup, that kind of thing. But at least you could do it, you know. It was a bit odd, but you could do it, you could get it done, and it was all right. In terms of auditions nowadays, you're auditioning in the house, you set your camera up on your phone or your iPad, you film yourself and you send it off as an email. It's a bit odd, but then again, you're in the house doing it. So, you know, you're not going anywhere. So there's ways around it. And, you know, it's just kind of getting on with it, I think. I mean, as I say, I do hope sooner rather than later. I mean, I don't fancy the rest of this year carrying on under lockdown or some kind of local lockdown. Yeah. I do hope things can get back to normal, because we need to, I think. I'm sure they will, it's just when, you know.
It was strange out here, what I do, we were completely locked down, everywhere was closed. Reopened in October to 25% capacity, and you have to come in with your mask. And so say like you and me went in and sat at the end of the bar, there's a sign that the next party's got to be 6 feet away. So another guy couldn't sit next to us, he'd have to sit 6 feet away. It's each party. So they did that. Then it went to 50%. It was March, just before Paddy's Day. It was 100%. And then all them signs went and it was, come on in.
Well, that's it. But they're talking, if on July the 19th, the government decides, we're coming out of this sort of like phase we're in now.
Yeah.
Talking about saying to people, you don't have to wear a mask anymore, or it's optional. So I think they've got to see. I mean, I don't think this virus is going to disappear. So we're going to have to learn to live with it. So there's got to be a way forward. There's got to be a route back to some kind of normality. You would like to think, I mean, our government I'm not overly impressed with. So, you know, I don't know what's going to happen. Yeah. But there's got to be surely some kind of way forward. I mean, the last time I went to the pub, it was very odd. I sort of sat up a corner of the table. And what I like to do normally is stand at the bar.
Yeah.
I talk to the locals in my pub because they're all my cronies. We all stand there talking rubbish all night. And then suddenly you can't do that. And to me, that's not any fun to go to the pub. You know, I don't see the point. You can't stand and chat to your mates or you've all got to be separate. That to me isn't the fun of going the boozer.
Yeah.
So hopefully, you know, we can get a bit back to a bit more of that and a bit more of normality. I mean, I've had my jabs. I wear the mask and I've done the very best that I can do.
Same here. There's a lot of people, I mean, I try not to get political. It's mixed feelings. Do you get it? Do you not get it? But
well, I haven't, but I've known people who have had it. Yeah. I've known people who have lost people, sadly.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it's becoming along these issues, isn't it, where people argue. So if it's not politics, it's now wearing a mask, not wearing a mask.
Mm.
And you go, at some point, we have to stop the arguing and find some way of getting on with it, you know.
I know.
I mean, I wish it'd go away tomorrow. I suspect it won't. But I need personally to get back to some kind of normality in my life because I've done a year and a bit of it. You know what I mean? And I think I've done everything I possibly can. So let's see, you know.
Like when we opened here, it was a nightmare for me in the beginning because I've got the microphone.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's up to me to say down the microphone as they're coming in. You know, the staff are helping as well. The staff are wear your mask, and I've got to say it on the microphone because it's coming through the speaker and it tries to get their attention more. But we had two couples dancing one night, and I said, "You've got to wear your mask while you're dancing. You're not wearing yours while you're singing."
Yeah,
that was the comeback. But I said, "I'm sitting down." That was my defense, you know. But yeah, a lot to deal with. It was a lot to deal with the mask situation. Now it's optional now, but there's a lot of people who've had the vaccines, so that's it.
Well,
so,
that's it. Yeah. I tell you the thing, you can't win, because if somebody's really against wearing a mask and they're really sort of angry about it, then you can't really have a recent conversation about it. It's one of those weird ones. If people are either really, you know, angry about it or they go along with it, there doesn't seem to be any kind of middle ground, which is sad. And this, I mean, social media, it's full of people who've got theories about it all, some of which are completely ludicrous. There's other people going, no, you've got to get jabs, you've got to wear your mask. Mm-hmm. It's just another source of conflict.
Yeah.
In the same way that in Britain we were arguing about Brexit forever. It's now masks, you know, so I don't know. I mean, I'm just hoping for better days and better days soon.
Me too, especially, you know, for the arts, people like yourself, you know. Yeah, but you can go to your local now. You can get your pint, yeah?
Oh, yeah, you can go and sit in what's euphemistically known as a beer garden, which tends to be a bench by the side of the road. And, you know, I kid you not, a month or two ago, the weather over here was really bad for a couple of days on the hailstones. And I promise you, there were people sat outside pubs in the hailstones with the coat zipped up, with hail bouncing in and out of their pints, sitting there. And there was something very brave and heroic about it. There was something that I had to, I couldn't knock them for it. There are people in this country, I mean, I'm sure where you are, it's very warm. But as you know, Britain, it has its moments, and there's been people sat outside in more or less the snow, not giving in. So, yeah, I mean, I've done a bit. I sat with my mates outside the pub, and buses were going past spraying us with gravel and fumes, and it was perishing, but we sat there and we had our pint. And it was great and awful at the same time, but we did it, you know what I mean? So, yeah, it's slowly opening up. And more the pubs are slowly opening up. And, you know, bit of normality again. You know, it's necessary.
Warren, it's been a pleasure, mate. Hope the theatres are opening again soon. Hope you're back on stage as well as on our screens again. And thank you so much for joining us. It's great to be in touch again.
Hey, well, listen, it's been an absolute pleasure doing it. And more power to you.
Thank you, buddy.